Thanks. Didn't he do great? He just gets better every week. All right. Welcome back, y'all. It's January. It's January 22. Let's stand and let's celebrate God. This one, I want to encourage you guys. Shake the dust off. Lift the hands if you feel like it. Sing it out loud.
To love you. You are good and you are kind. You bring joy into my life. And you make it easy to trust you. You have never left my side. You've been faithful.
Amen, Lord. We follow you anywhere, Lord. We thank you for every single person in this auditorium tonight. You called all of them here for a specific reason, Lord. I pray that they would embrace that and they would follow you. In your name we pray, amen. Please have a seat.
Branch, welcome back. It feels like forever since we've been together. Almost been like a year. Okay, Kyle told me that joke, so it's him. If you guys would have laughed, I would have taken credit, but Kyle told me the joke. I just had to share it with you guys. No, hope you guys had a Merry Christmas. Enjoying a Happy New Year. Christmas break as a high schooler has got to be like one of the best times of your lives, right? Like 2 weeks, you can do whatever you want, and it always goes by way too fast. As I get older, though, and we have some foster kids in the home, it's illegal how long Christmas break is. I was so happy to get them back in school. No, I'm glad you guys are here tonight. One thing that kids love to do, leaders, if you've raised kids, you'll know this. Students, if you've had siblings who you've grown up and they were young this age and you were able to see them when they were 3-year-old, what do 3-year-olds love to do? Like besides pick their nose and make fart sounds, what do they love to do? They love to ask questions. They ask questions all the time, and they don't just ask them once. Ask them 5-6 billion times. And it's like, as a father figure, I'm trying to stay patient. I'm trying to teach them right from wrong, all these things. But at some point, I can only explain to you what your Hot Wheel is 3 different ways. Like, I don't know what he's expecting me. Like, I'm going to pull out all these scientific words, but it's crazy. And I was reflecting on that the other day. And so many times I feel like we're like that with God, where we're just asking him so many questions. And whether you're new to your faith or you're walking through a season maybe where you're struggling, maybe you've had something given to you or a circumstance that you're walking through that you don't feel is fair, and we start asking God so many questions. Maybe some of us were even questioning God. We're doubting God. Is he good? Does he have a plan for my life? Why is this happening to me? And unlike me, right, the truth, the comfort that we find in our Heavenly Father is that he is patient, that he holds all wisdom, and that he welcomes our questions. It's okay to have questions. In fact, if we look at the Gospel of Luke, John the Baptist, he's this forerunner for Christ, right? He's paving the way for Jesus. He even has questions, so he sends his disciples to ask Jesus a question. And they say this, John the Baptist sent us to ask, are you the Messiah we've been expecting, or should we keep looking for someone else? It's just such a blunt and bold question. It's basically saying like, hey, Jesus, are you the Son of God? Like, are you the one the prophets have been telling us about? Because if not, that's cool. Keep doing your thing, but we're going to look somewhere else, right? They just ask him that. I love Jesus' response. He says, and he answered them, go and tell John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the poor have good news brought to them, and blessed is anyone who takes no offense at me. Right? John the Baptist has questions. He's doubting Jesus here. And instead of Jesus making him feel bad or shaming him, right, he welcomes the question. He answers John in a way that John would understand. He says, I'm Jesus. I'm accomplishing what the Messiah is supposed to accomplish. And so what I love and what I think we can see here tonight is this. God can handle our doubts, and he welcomes our questions. God can handle our doubts, and he welcomes our questions. Good news for us. We're starting a two-week series tonight and next week called Questions for God. Pastor Jeff's going to come and give the message next week. But the question that we're going to dive into tonight is a question that I really feel like you guys are asking. Whether I've had a conversation with you or your small group leaders have, and I've had a conversation with your small group leaders, and I don't think you're asking this question specifically. You're kind of bouncing around it, but I think if we boil it down, this is the question that you're asking. It's this. How can I break free from the cycle of sin? Like, I find myself in habitual sin, a sin that I can't keep kicking. Right? How can I break free from the cycle of sin? It's a loaded question. It's an intense question. Maybe some of you are kind of like, whoa, what's he going tonight? So before we go any further, I just love to pray for tonight. So if you pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you for tonight. Thank you for everybody in this room. God, that you have a plan and a purpose for tonight. Lord, we just pray that any walls that we've put up that were preventing us to be vulnerable and open and honest, God, that you would tear those down tonight. Help us to stand in the truth of your word, to refuse any of the lies that the devil is trying to tell us. God, would tonight magnify, glorify, and honor you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So tonight, to dive into this question, I think a good place for us to start is we need to start to look at what sin is. And then what I want to do with you guys is take a look at a couple of the different strategies that the devil tries to use to keep us stuck in our sin. So what's sin? First John gives us a pretty simple and clear definition. It's this. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. Sin is any thought, word, action that goes against God's holy and perfect standard, right? It's rebellion against our Creator, the way He's created to live and to flourish. That's what sin is. And we're all guilty of it. And here's the thing about sin, whether it's lust or lying or cheating or pride or messing around with substances, stealing, the way we speak to each other, seeing something that we know we should do but we don't do it, what it does is it drives a wedge between us and God. It drives a wedge between us and God. And what the devil would love to do more than anything else is take that wedge and keep hammering it in farther and farther. We would call this a foothold. And I think the devil has a couple different strategies that he wants to use to do this to us. And I see it so much in conversations with you guys, and my heart just breaks for you. It's this: shame and isolation. The devil wants to use shame and isolation. Right? Shame says, I am bad. Guilt says, I've done something bad. Shame is what the devil wants to use. Shame causes us to run to hide from God versus in repentance, seeking forgiveness, and turning towards God. I think we see shame in the first book of the Bible in Genesis. Adam and Eve, right, they commit the first sin in the Garden of Eden. God tells them not to eat the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and they do. The serpent convinces them to do so. This is what the scripture says. It says, the woman was convinced. She saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too. At that moment, their eyes were opened, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness. So they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. When the cool evening breezes were blowing, the man and his wife heard the Lord God walking about in the garden. Pause real quick. Up until this point, Adam and Eve lived with a perfect relationship with God, in unbroken communion with God. They had no reason to hide from him. But then what does Scripture say? They heard the Lord God walking about in the garden, so they hid from the Lord God among the trees. Shame causes us to run, to hide, to turn away from God's presence, where that's what the devil wants us to do. He wants to use shame to get us to run away instead of run towards God, seeking forgiveness and repentance. Another common tactic the devil uses is isolation, right? The devil wants you to feel like you are the only one going through what you're going through. That you're just out there on an island, there's no way anybody could relate to you. And I think that social media has really made this increase where everybody, you scroll on Instagram, what is it? It's everybody's best life, and you're like, no way they could struggle with what I'm struggling with, right? The devil wants you to feel like you're the only one struggling with what you're struggling with, whether it's lust. He wants you to think you're the only one struggling with lust. He wants you to think you're the only one struggling with pride and ego, maybe messing around with substances you shouldn't be messing around with stealing, with cheating on homework at school. Maybe it's looking at porn. Maybe it's struggling to treat others with love. Maybe it's vanity and trying to get accepted by your outward looks and what you post on social media and all that stuff. Maybe it's struggling to do what you know you should do, but you don't do it. He wants you to feel like you're the only one that struggles with what you're struggling with. That's what he wants to do in isolation. But if we expose that lie to truth we find in the Bible, this is what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians. It says, no temptation has overtaken you except what? What is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. No temptation has overtaken you except for what? What is common to mankind. In response to the devil's lie of isolation, we find that whatever we're going through, we're not uniquely tempted by it, right? If we look around the room here, there's probably about 100 people in here tonight, right? At least one person, if not likely many, many more, at least one person is struggling with what you're struggling with or has already struggled with what you're struggling with. But the devil wants us to feel like we're isolated. And if you ever ask yourself, why do we do small groups on Wednesday nights? Right? Is it just to hang out? No, this is time where we can really get deep. We can dive into these things. We can be honest. James 5 tells us that when we confess our sins to one another and pray for one another, we find healing. Some of us in here, we need healing. That's where healing begins, when we're being open and honest and vulnerable. And another thing, we have community as believers, But as people and we believe in Christ, we have a relationship with Jesus. The writer of Hebrews tells us that he was tempted in every way that we were, yet without sin. So if you feel like nobody else could be tempted the way that you have, the Bible tells us that Jesus was. And he's sitting on the throne and he's your advocate. He's interceding for you. And he's been where you've been. He's been tempted in every way. He knows what it's like. You're not alone. I want you guys to know that tonight. You're not alone. Look around the room. The devil wants you to feel isolated. You're not. You're not alone. We've looked at sin, right? What sin is. We've looked at a couple of different strategies that the devil wants to use to keep us stuck in our sin. What's the solution, right? What's the solution? How do we break free from the cycle of sin? How do we get out of the rut and the hang-ups and the habits that we have that just keep us in the cycle of sin? Our solution is not a what, right? I can stand up here and say, hey, here's three steps that you guys can go home and do and you're going to be fine. Hey, read this book, you'll be good. All right, our solution is not a what, it's a who. And it's the person of Jesus. And this is a great time to be diving into this with you guys because a couple weeks ago, what did we celebrate? We celebrated the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus. He was born into this world as the Messiah, as Yeshua, the one who would rescue, the one who would deliver, the one who would set his people free. Right, and the problem with this, though, why so many people, the Jewish people, missed him as their Messiah was because they were expecting somebody that was going to come set them free from their earthly captors, the Romans. They thought somebody was going to come in with military might, and they were going to conquer the Romans, and they were going to squish the Romans under their feet. So when Jesus didn't do that, they dismissed him as the Messiah. But Jesus did come as a conqueror, and he did come to set his people free. He came to set us free from the thing that causes death in us, the thing that is not just the Jewish people's enemy, but all of our enemies, the thing that destroys relationships in us, the thing that keeps us from living life and freedom in Christ, and that's sin. He came to conquer that. He did that. He did that by living a sinless, perfect life, by obediently going to the cross to suffer a criminal's death, being buried and rising again triumphantly 3 days later. Jesus is our solution. But we got an action step tonight. I wanted to send you guys home with an action step. And what's our action step? We see it all throughout the New Testament. It's actually one of the very first things that Jesus proclaims when he starts his ministry in Matthew chapter 4, and it's this. It's repentance. It's repentance, which means to turn away from sin with disgust, sorrow, and a determination not to repeat the action. It's repentance. It's what he's calling us to. And if we're turning away from something, we must be turning towards something or someone. So if we're turning away from sin and self, we're turning towards Christ. That's why the Christian life is oftentimes referred to as a walk. It's not stationary. We're always walking. We're either walking towards sin and self, or we're walking towards and we're walking with God. Paul talks about this in his letter to the Corinthians, right? In his first letter to the Corinthians, he sees he's got this deep pain, this deep grief for the Corinthians. They have this sinfulness in their church. And he calls him out on it. He writes them a letter and he calls him out on it. And then in the second letter, this is what he says. Now I'm glad I sent it, the letter. Not because it hurt you, but because the pain caused you to repent and change your ways. It was the kind of sorrow God wants his people to have. So you were not harmed by us in any way. For the kind of sorrow God wants us to experience leads us away from sin and results in salvation. There's no regret for that kind of sorrow. But worldly sorrow, which lacks repentance, results in spiritual death. Paul's saying here to the Corinthians, you saw the sins that you were committing, and you felt godly sorrow over them. Not because you got caught, right? Not because we were busted in the act. Not because Paul wrote a letter calling out the Corinthians. That's not why they felt sorrow. They felt sorrow because they recognized what they were doing was an affront to God. They recognized that it was driving a wedge between them and God. And it led to repentance, and it led them to turn to Christ, and it led them to find salvation in Jesus. And so tonight what we're going to do is I want to give you guys an opportunity to just do just that. The worship team's going to come back out and lead us in a song, and we're going to pull the cross up here right in front. We're going to have post-it note stations here, 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 and there. And what I want you guys to do, what I want to encourage you guys to do, is enter into prayer. Have a conversation with God, an open, honest, vulnerable conversation with God. And reflect on where you've been struggling, where you've been sinning, where you can't seem to kick it. And we're going to come up, you can write them, and we're going to nail them to the cross. I'll give you time to do that now.
feel it in this room. Holy Spirit, it's when you have your way, something has to break. Tear down every lie, set the wrong thing right. It's when you have your way, something has to break. Something has to break. Oh, oh, oh. I feel it in this room. Holy Spirit, it's when you hide away. Something has to break. Tear down every lie, set the wrong thing right. 'Cause when you have your way, something has to break. Something has to break. Something has to break right now in your name. Something has to break. Something.
Father, thank you for bringing us all here tonight safely. I pray that your message was poured into these kids' hearts. And I pray as they go into small groups that you allow a breaking point so that your worship and your heart can just fill them back up again. In your name, amen. When you guys are done, you're dismissed.
Yeah. No, you're good. Hey, before you go quick, just want to challenge you guys. I love to challenge you because I want to see you grow. This idea of repentance and looking at the cross and remembering what Jesus, it's not just something that we do when we sing songs about it or we hear a message about it or we're told to do it during worship. Like, this is a part of our daily walk with Christ. And it's what Jesus died to give us freedom. And when we hold on our sin, when we hide in shame, when we let ourselves feel isolated instead of coming into community with each other, like, that's what the devil wants. And so I just pray that you guys know that you're not alone, that when you nail these to the cross, like Colossians 2:14 says that he canceled all of our sins. He nailed them to the cross. You guys are free in Jesus. I'm going to pray for us real quick before you go. And when we go to small groups tonight, if there's some conversations that need to be had, like, can we just all agree for a second, like, be 100% for real? Like, what happens in small group, like, if we really want to get deep and we want to see life change and we want to see growth and we want to grow in our faith and we want to see our friends grow in their faith, what happens in small group doesn't leave. It's not at the lunchroom table the next day and it's not over a text chat. It stays. We all agree on that? I love you guys so much. I'm going to pray for us. Heavenly Father, thank you for tonight. Thank you for the gift of Jesus. Thank you that when we confess our sins that you are just to forgive and you cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God, I just pray for these students and the seniors who are entering their graduation year and just all this stuff that's going on. And I'm not a high schooler now, but I just can tell that there's just tons thrown at them and the world's trying to tell them their identity. And God, I just pray that they would find their identity in you tonight, that they would rest in that, that they would find freedom in you, Jesus. Jesus, we thank you that you went to the cross obediently, that you suffered death, that you died, that you rose again, and that you free us. And who the Son sets free is free indeed. We can live in freedom. Jesus, I pray over small groups. I pray that we could be honest and open and vulnerable. God, that everything would glorify and point to you. Jesus, we ask this all in your name. Amen. Love you guys. They choked his fame like weeds.